Welcome to Christ Virtual Church, from my heart to your home. I want to let you know something right now. You know, I'm looking at a camera right now, but I'm seeing you. I'm seeing your face. I really love the responses I get from people on Facebook and on our church website. And you know what I love the most? I love when you send me maybe a picture that one of your kids drew or something like that. I love those pictures like that. And I want you to know, if you've done that, I've gotten it and I love it and I thank you for it. So thank you so much for that and kind of encouragement that you send my way every single week. And I'll tell you what, I want to ask you right now, how are you feeling? How are you doing this week? Are you feeling a little bit stressed out? Well, let me tell you something. If you've got a problem, God's got a plan. If you've got a situation, God's got a solution. That's how great our God is. In fact, as we worship Him right now, here's our young people recorded live in worship with "Great Are You, Lord."
Darkness, you give hope, you restore.
Well, people of God, feel it in your heart this morning. Feel it in your heart. Feel it in your heart. Because it's all right to get a little bit emotional. We are going to have a happy Sunday. Thanks so much for being here now. Let me tell you, there was a young woman once, a woman who was a member of her church's prayer team, and she and her husband had been trying to have a baby for years. I mean, month after month, they would try and nothing would happen. And many times, as a member of her church's prayer team, she would pray for other couples who wanted to have a baby. And often she would see these couples walk into church and they'd have a brand new baby in their arms and they'd be so happy and so fulfilled. But she would see their prayers get answered. But she never saw an answer to her prayers. And that young lady looks to the whole world like she's got it all together. She looks like she has it all. I mean, she's beautiful and successful. She has a beautiful home. She's got a great husband. What you can't see, though, when you look at her, what you can't see is that secret frustration. That frustration that she carries deep in her heart that just kind of eats away at her. And I'm wondering right now, how about you? How many of you have kind of a frustration that you just wish, you wish God would do something about it? Like maybe you see other people get well and your medical condition just doesn't seem to get any better. Maybe your coworkers are getting promoted and you produce just as much and you work just as hard, but it's like nobody notices you. Or maybe it seems like all the friends that you grew up with are doing just great right now. They're moving along in life. They've got a great job. Maybe they're married and starting a family. Maybe they've got a house of their own. But you're kind of stuck, aren't you? You're kind of stuck, and to be honest, you don't know how to break out of that holding pattern. And it's frustrating. And the point is, all of us seem to have these secret frustrations. Things that we want God to change. And things that we know that God could change. We know that God could open up that door for us. We know that He could remove that temptation from our life. We know that God could give us that baby that we've been longing for. But it's just not happening for us. Well, here's my advice to you. Don't get stuck on the why questions of life. You have to realize that God is sovereign. God is on His throne. God is in control. And God is always thinking at a much higher level than you and I are. You can't expect that you're always going to understand why God does something or why He doesn't do something. You just have to trust that God loves you and He's going to do what's best for you. But I'll tell you what I know is true. If you'll just keep the right attitude while you're going through this, all those frustrating situations that are not changing in your life, and all those frustrating conditions that God is not removing from your life, they won't work against you. They're going to work for you. Don't let all the contradictions in life cause you to get sour and to give up on your dreams. Let me show you how you can fight back, how you can fight that feeling of frustration. There are really three keys to this. The first thing is this. Don't let the thorns steal your joy. Let me say it again. Don't let those thorns steal your joy. And here's what I'm getting at. The Apostle Paul, who wrote almost half of the New Testament, talked about those secret frustrations. You see, God used Paul in a mighty way. God used Paul for great things, but as effective as Paul was, he had a secret frustration. He called it his thorn in the flesh. Now, scholars today love to debate about exactly what that thorn in the flesh might have been for Paul. Most of them will argue that it was probably a physical condition, like maybe malaria or migraine headaches, or maybe Paul had some eye problems that left him almost totally blind. Others will argue that, no, we think he had some emotional problems. After all, he was being constantly persecuted by people. And even some factions of the church were coming against him. I even heard one scholar argue that it sounded to him like Paul had marriage problems. And I know some of you wives listening right now, you're saying, thorn in my flesh? Yeah, that pretty much sounds like my husband. Whatever it was, though, whatever it was that was bothering Paul, Paul prayed over and over to God to please remove that problem. One translation of the Bible says that Paul implored God to take it away. That means Paul gave it his best shot. He gave God his best argument. He said, God, I've been serving you. God, I've been working real hard. God, I've been real effective. And I have prayed for others, and they've been healed. But God, you haven't healed me. God, please take away this thorn from my flesh. Maybe Paul was saying, I'm just tired of being hassled by people. I'm tired of this sickness and this disease pulling me down. I'm tired of all these constant headaches in my life. God, please remove this thorn from my flesh. And you would think, wouldn't you? You would think that if anybody had some pull with God, it would be Paul. But what's interesting to me is this. God never removed that thorn. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 that God's answer to him was this: my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. In other words, my grace is more than enough for you. And when you feel the weakest, that's when my power shines through the most in your life. How about you? How about all your secret frustrations? Is there something that you have implored God to change in your life? Maybe a situation at work. Maybe a chronic health problem. Maybe a troubled relationship. You have asked God again and again, but nothing seems to improve. I'm not saying to give up. What I'm saying is, if God's not removing it, if God's not changing it, don't let it steal your joy. Don't let it sour your life. God has given you the grace to be there. You see, the right attitude is, I'm not going to let this frustration, this thorn in my flesh, frustrate me anymore. God, I know that your grace, and God, I know that your goodness is more than enough for me. I have the power to live with this and have a good attitude. I believe at the right time, you're going to change this. But God, even if you never change it, I'm still going to do my best to live the kind of life you want me to live and to honor you with my life. You just have to make up your mind about that frustration. If that issue with your spouse doesn't change, if your health doesn't improve, if you have to put up with that grouchy boss for the rest of your life, if you have to live with that temptation until the day you die, you're not going to complain. You're going to tap into God's grace. You're going to tap into God's goodness, because that's more than enough for you. That means you absolutely can enjoy your life in spite of those secret frustrations. What am I saying? Don't let those thorns steal your joy. And let me give you another key to fighting this. Don't focus on your frustration. Don't focus on that frustration in your life. Paul could have gone around thinking, God, why don't you remove this from me? But if Paul allowed himself to focus on that and get stuck in that kind of place, he would have been miserable every single day of his life, and he would have missed out on all the other good stuff. And it's the same for you. It's the same for me. It's easy to get stuck. It's easy to focus on the frustration. It's easy to keep asking God why he hasn't changed our child or caused our business to grow. But instead, choose faith. Faith is trusting God even when your life doesn't make sense. Once there was a man by the name of Smith Wigglesworth. Now, I want to tell you this story today, not only because that is the most awesome name that I've ever heard, Smith a Wigglesworth, but because Wigglesworth had his own little battle going on with secret frustration. Back in the 1900s, Wigglesworth was a popular preacher who drew hundreds of people to his healing services. He saw all kinds of miracles. He witnessed remarkable healings take place right in front of his very eyes. But Wigglesworth himself suffered most of his life from kidney stones. I mean, have you ever had a kidney stone? Do you want to give a testimony right now? I've had more than one woman tell me she'd rather give birth to a 9-pound baby than try to pass a kidney stone. There were times when Wigglesworth would go home after one of his healing services in so much pain he could barely walk. He would crawl into his house, lie on the floor in a fetal position, hour after hour, just trying to get some relief. Here he was. He had just seen God do great miracles, but he didn't receive his own miracle. Like Paul, Wigglesworth could have been bitter. Wigglesworth could have thought, this is just not right, God. You healed them, you could have healed me. This isn't fair. Instead, he had this attitude: your goodness and your grace is enough for me. Even when I don't understand it, even when it doesn't seem fair, I'm still going to trust you. I'm not going to let this frustration keep me from my destiny. And you see, if you're going to reach your full potential, you got to be a Wigglesworth. You've got to stand up and be a Wigglesworth. You can't be a weakling. You got to be a warrior. You got to tell yourself, I'm not a whiner. I'm a winner. I'm not a victim. I'm a victor. I'm not a loser. I'm a chooser. There will always be things you don't understand, things that don't make sense to you. But God knows what he's doing. If you're supposed to have it, you'll find a way. If it's supposed to be removed, he'll remove it. If you're supposed to live with that for the rest of your life, he'll give you the strength to do just that. You will have the grace you need for every situation. What am I saying? Don't let those thorns steal your joy. And don't focus on your frustration. And then you'll be able to walk in a place of peace. That's really the third key. You'll want to walk every day in a place of peace. In fact, let me walk you back right now to the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, Moses was told by God to go to Pharaoh and say to Pharaoh, you will let my people go. But Moses was insecure. He had been a shepherd out in the wilderness for 40 years, and he didn't feel qualified to do anything like that. He said, God, how will they know you sent me? I don't have any influence. I don't have any power. Why would they even believe me? God said, Moses, what do you have in your hand right now? Moses said, this old thing? Well, this is just my old wooden shepherd's staff. God said, Moses, throw your staff down on the ground. Moses looked puzzled. That's kind of weird, he's thinking. But he did it, and immediately that wooden staff became a snake. And Moses said, whoa, nice. God said, pick it up now. Moses said, what you talking about? It's a snake. I'm not going to touch it. God just rolled his eyes and said, Moses, pick it up right now. So Moses did it, and immediately when he touched it, it turned back into a wooden staff. Moses said, nice. God said, put your hand in your pocket now. So Moses put his hand in his pocket. Take it out. He took out his hand, and the whole thing was covered with leprosy. Moses said, whoa. God said, put it back in your pocket. He did that. Then he took it out again, and his whole hand was just as perfect and as good as a brand new baby's hand. Moses said, nice. God showed Moses all these signs so that when he went to the palace of Pharaoh, he'd have confidence that God was going to be with him and God could do absolutely anything. But then Moses had another concern. He said, God, you've shown me all these great miracles, and I must say, very cool, very cool. But I can't go stand before Pharaoh because I stutter and I stammer. And that would not be cool. Well, you know, you would have thought, since God just did all those miracles, he would simply kind of stretch out his hand and touch Moses' tongue. and take away that stuttering and take away that stammering. But God didn't do that. He didn't remove the problem. God was saying to Moses what he said to Paul. My power shows up greatest in your weakness. If I needed to remove that so you could fulfill your destiny, then I would have already have removed it. Well, let me ask you something. Is there something that you've been waiting for God to remove before you could be happy, before you could pursue a dream, before you can get your dream or move forward, or rather get your degree and move forward in life? Listen to me. You have what you need. Wherever you are right now, whatever you're doing, look me right in the eye and listen to me. You have what you need. If God's not removing it, it's not an accident. If God's not providing it, you don't need it. If God's not changing what you want him to change in your life, there's a reason for it. You may not see it. It may not make sense to you, but you have to trust in God's love and trust in God's goodness and grace. He always has your best interests at heart. So walk in a place of peace. Walk in a place of peace instead of frustration. Don't live frustrated because a problem isn't turning around. Don't live stressed out because a family member isn't doing the right thing. Don't get upset because a dream is taking too long. Come back to that place of peace. Friend, don't let that frustration steal your joy. Don't let it keep you in a dark place. Have a new perspective. You have the grace for anything that you're facing. If God's not removing it, there's a reason. Don't try to figure it out. Trust him. And if you do this, here's my promise to you. You will not only enjoy life more, but God will remove everything that's supposed to be removed and give you everything that you're supposed to have. And you will rise higher and you will push away the obstacles and you will become everything you were created to become. Let's go to God now. Let's go to God now and bring him our frustrations in this moment of prayer. And let me ask you something as you bow your head. What's your secret frustration? Yeah, you don't like to talk about it, do you? But it kind of eats away at you. What's been bothering you? What's been disappointing you? That's your thorn in the flesh, isn't it? So let's take that thorny issue to the Lord right now. Dear Lord Jesus, please help me to trust you and trust your timing. I don't want to let that thorn steal my joy. So when I start to feel my frustration build, I'm going to focus on your grace and your goodness. And Lord, I'm going to walk in a place of peace. I know that if you're not removing that problem from me, it's not an accident. If you're not changing it, there's a reason. I may not see it. It may not make sense to me, but I trust you. And so my heart is in a good place right now, a place of peace, a place of peace instead of frustration. Jesus, I pray this in your name. Amen. And now we continue by praying together the timeless words of our Lord Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, you know, maybe you've been down and discouraged lately. Maybe you've been fed up and frustrated. Maybe you've been listening to all the wrong voices. You are not who they say you are. You are not who your doubts and fears say you are. You are who he says you are. Here's our young people recorded live in worship with who you say I am.
His love for me, oh, his love for me.
Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am.
Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me.
Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. The sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
Well, I want to thank you so much for joining us this week. It really means so much to me, so thank you from my heart for being a part of our ministry in the way that you are. Even if I can't see you right now, I know that you are out there, you are actively supporting our ministry, and you're praying for us all the time. So thank you so much for that. And I want to invite you to join us again next week as we wrap up our series on emotions. Next week, we're going to look at when you get that overwhelmed feeling. And I'm going to build up that warrior mentality in you, because I want you to know that even when you feel overwhelmed, God has built some bounce back into you. Next week, we're going to talk about it, feeling overwhelmed. Well, our final act of worship today is to bring our gift of support to our God. So I invite you to go to our website. If you're not there right now, go to clcsouthwick.org. That's clcsouthwick.org. And click on the giving tab right there on the home page. And for our final blessing today, let me remind you of the word of God that I've been speaking over you every week throughout this series. Because friend, the next time you feel the first flicker of anxiety, the next time your heart is feeling overwhelmed, the next time you feel the fire of frustration heating up in your life, may these words rise up in your mind and settle deep in your heart. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus our Lord. May it be a reality in your life that you can feel this week when you need it the most. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. And go now with joy. We will, for we go with God. Thanks, everybody. See you next week.